Good morning, ladies and gentlemen. Actually, it's not, I don't have to share my thoughts. I have to introduce you the person who's going to follow me, who's the main man who's going to talk about radicalization, talk about internet, talk about the grey world, the grey areas in the digital age. He's the man who I'm going to talk about. Mr. Asif Ibrahim, if you could come up on stage, please. It's my proud privilege to introduce Mr. Asif Ibrahim, who is Prime Minister Narendra Modi's Special Envoy on Counterterrorism and Extremism and a former Director of Intelligence Bureau. Now, what is this hardcore intelligence man, a counter-terror specialist, doing in an education conference is a question that would be propping in your mind. And what is the topic, Grey in the Digital Age, a perspective on bringing up children in New India, got to do with a policeman? The answer is that among the many hats that Mr. Asif Ibrahim wears in the Modi government, he's also in charge of the counter-radicalization program. With internet being the new god century, the school-going children are susceptible to early religious radicalization through this all-powerful and yet uncontrolled medium. It is this medium that is being exploited by the religious and terrorist groups like Islamic State and others. Mr. Ibrahim, I'm sure, will be able to provide you with insights into the role that the digital world plays in radicalization. Let me give you a brief introduction of Mr. Asif Ibrahim. Mr. Ibrahim was inducted into Indian Police Service in 1977 and spent his six formative years in anti-divorce program in Madhya Pradesh state, with stints in Morena, Gwalior, Bhind, Datia and Guna, fighting Malkhan Singh and Phulan Devi. He moved on to become the private secretary to then Railway Minister Madhav Rao Sindhya, OSD to the Home Minister Mufti Muhammad Saeed, and then OSD to Prime Minister Chandrasekhar. Mr. Ibrahim was posted in Srinagar in 1990s during the peak militancy days, and he has seen what Kashmir was in 1990s. He served in London for 3 years with the Intelligence Bureau. He debuted office as Director of Intelligence Bureau in December 2014 after a very successful tenure during which he broke the back of Indian Mujahideen terror group. In fact, it's my belief that the peace that you're seeing right now is partly or maybe largely due to his efforts as to how he managed the counterterrorism program. Ladies and gentlemen, please welcome Mr. Asif Ibrahim.
Thank you, Shishir, and thank you, Shantanu, for inviting me here. As Shishir has pointed out, in fact, what is a policeman doing here? What is an intelligence person doing here? It's August gathering of eminent teachers, professors, principals, educationists, academia. And I'm also in a quandary as to how to begin my address to you. In our profession, normally we know much about the audience before we start speaking. But today, I'm at a loss. I don't know the nature of questions and probably what's in your mind, because I've just been brought here to just share a few thoughts with you. So please bear with me if I digress from the topic, which I have not understood myself, you know, gray area and then going into education. So I start with that, Raida, that please forgive me if I am digressing, because the topic itself has no boundaries. I was just listening to the young MPs here, and I was very fortunate to have been present here, because their views on what they see education should be or what they have in mind. You know, education is an aspirational subject. We all go to schools with a certain amount of aspiration. Though at that young stage, or that tender age, we don't know what we are going to do, but the parents have some aspirations for us. And the molding starts in the primary schools. Therefore, and when people come out, pass out, at, have degrees, that is where frustration starts. When frustration starts, you have social tensions. And that is where the element of security comes in. Over the past 50 years, my children, when they were going to school here, I don't think they enjoyed the same amount of liberties of a child, which we did. Childhood is important because this is the age when people, ya bacche, you know, they have no fixed ideas. They can meet anybody. They can venture into uncharted areas. Gali mein bhi khel lenge, cricket idhar bhi chale jayenge. Now that is the experience. Jo digital age mein, we suddenly find missing. That strong sense of interpersonal relationship is today what is missing in our society. Aaj ki tarikh mein, in today's world, a youngster sits in his room, his world is limited to 4 feet by 4 feet. That is the workstation where he places his computer. And he is in a virtual world most of the time, talking to his friends. Now, most of the things, it can be argued that this is a positive development. For instance, during our time when we had to borrow a book from the library, we had to take a bus, go to a bus stand, maybe wait for the bus. There was this Mumphali wala jisse baat hoti thi, then the passenger, then go to the library, you find that book has been issued in somebody's name. You approach that person. So to get one book, one had to talk to at least 20, 30 people. Today, it's the Google and you get that book. So you do get your book, you do get the content, but you miss out on your daily interpersonal relationships. The result is, at the end of the day, that child emerges as an individual. We are not looking at society as a whole. I heard that General V.K. Singh was talking about national spirit and patriotism. And the young MPs were also talking about that. But you know, this has to be inculcated not as nationalism. Nationalism per se is not what I am talking about. It's what you do as a citizen of the nation that is nationalism. Now, why I am stressing most all the time that it is the strength of a nation is in education. Because you will groom the strength of tomorrow. And why I am again stressing on this point is that when I see radicalization emerging all over the world, through the internet, that's when we started actually getting to the root of the problem. When a person traverses this journey from point A, let's say shared values, he leaves his shared values, his friends, and then moves on to a virtual world. That happens because his roots are not very strong, or that he has lost his stakes in his roots. Unfortunately, today, people have very little stakes. It was pointed out earlier that since there are less job opportunities or opportunities in India, we travel abroad for doing well for ourselves. Yes, that may be a point. I'm not discussing about the educational aspects or the financial job opportunities that we get. But the shared values is what I am talking about.
And those shared values are inculcated right at the school level. When we were, and I'm sure most of you, our curriculum was such that we, for instance, I was in a convent school. Every morning one would go to the chapel and sing psalms and hymns. It never occurred to us then that this is not what our religion or what today's debate is all about. But that is how you learn each other's religion, each other's viewpoints. And then therein lies your strength. Now, what we see, let's say, in Europe. Initially, people thought that it is the wretched of the earth, people who do not have done well for themselves, would be drawn and attracted to a radical ideology. But now we see IT professionals, we see graduates from good universities getting sucked into the vortex of militancy. Obviously, they have had the best of education. But what is lacking there is this sense of belonging, sense of purpose in life. And that belonging and sense of purpose in life again can be inculcated by people like you. That is the most important ingredient of, or let's say, the bulwark against radicalization. Radicalization can never take place in a vacuum. It is only on, always on the basis of when people decide that their existence, their present existence, is not good enough for them. So they move away to another form, which is an illusion, but enough to give them the reason that, that therein lies their future. And today the in the ISIS, or the, I'm sure you will know, I will not explain what is ISIS.
That conditioned thinking comes down. Today's militants and radical groups have taken advantage of this. You want to know anything about Islam, and what you will get on the net is a particular way of thinking of Islam. That is the radical Salafi movement. So my request again to the academia here and the principals, please inculcate a sense of inquisitiveness amongst the students. They should not take everything for granted, whatever comes down from the internet. Because if they start doing the necessary inquiries, I'm sure they will get a complete picture. Therefore, in the coming years, we must evolve. I don't know how it can be done, but because internet is so convenient today that I think children are just hooked onto it. They will not give it up that easily, because everything is available there. But in schools, our effort should be that in our curriculum, in our teachings, this sense of questioning whatever is being dished out should be very much inculcated. Please.
I don't have a mic, but I think I'm audible, sir.
Yes.
So my question is that what you touched to is the right chord in the education system. Perhaps, pardon me, I'm just giving my mic.
Hello.
So you touched the right chord in the education system. You are with the right people, I think, at the moment. Being in a government, then talking about cyber terrorism, let me tell you that it's already into the schools. The children are well aware of technology, much more than the people who teach them. So I think from the government point of view, I thought it's time that we also address it at that level. We are very sensitive as principals, we are very sensitive as people who are concerned, but exactly what can we do to curb it at that level, or to make them much more knowledgeable, or to make it be used in a very positive manner? We need to be given directions, we need the government and the ministry to take it at a very serious level.
Law enforcement officers in Delhi, once in 6 months, have a chat with students there organized by the principals on security aspects, on radicalization, informal gatherings. At least let us make aware the students about the dangers of what they are downloading. You see, today it is taken as gospel truth, whatever they read on the internet. So, at that level, there can be an interaction. The other thing that needs to be done is to, again, strengthen the shared values of the nation, which are very, very strong, but need to be protected all the time, the friendship circle. Third is, of course, when we do talk to classmates, generally a classmate knows that there is something wrong with his friend. You know, because he starts pulling out from the circle of friends. Wo alag hatna shuru hota hai, because he's now getting on into a virtual community of his own. That is where signals, early signals have to be picked up. And finally, of course, it's the principals and the teachers who have to be, I mean, our course content should be such where we do discuss and deal with the national issues, the issues of social cohesion, plurality, etc., etc. Because that is the strength of the nation, as I mentioned earlier on, the civil society strength. We've seen what happened in Soviet Union, because Red Army, the KGB and nuclear power, but when the civil society got disturbed, it collapsed like a pack of cards. So those things do not provide the actual strength of the nation. They are there for different reasons. I hope this will satisfy you. If not, then please be, you are most welcome to come to our office and we can do it at great length. Thank you.
Hello, sir.
Or teaching of Islam can be again a bulwark or impediment to joining such groups. So I think I've made myself clear that I'm not linking it with Islam. But the problem comes up when, in their apocalyptic theory, you see, this ideology, why is it dangerous? Is that it believes in doomsday. It says there'll be a fight between the Christians and the Muslims. In the prophetic sense, it was Romans, which is now talked about Crusaders and then Christians. That is why it is inviting Americans to put their foot soldiers on the ground, so that there is a fight in Dabiq, which is a small town in Syria. The final doomsday, which according to Baghdadi's interpretation and many more, will be the final victory of Islam. Now, if you believe in doomsday theory, obviously you believe and you have reasons for love for death. That is why I mentioned love for death. Whereas, the counter narrative has to be that we give them enough reasons, good reasons, to love life. That is the counter narrative that around which we have to build our thesis. There is this question of death, there is this question of life. Satisfied, sir? Should I get into the roots of how Islam came to Kerala, or
Is there anybody else who wants to ask a question? One last question, please.
When we talk about perspective of bringing the students in the new India, technology is going to play a very important role. On the second hand, it is always seen that technology is putting a lot of negative impacts on the students, young students. According to you, to what extent the student should be exposed to these technologies, number one, and as a government, apart from the government side, what government is doing to take certain measures or actions to restrict certain information that should not be accessed to the students so that they do not get into those lines where the examples of Hyderabad occurs, where a student joins, tries to join ISIS or tries to access the websites of terrorists and become like that. So what is the actions taken by the government, number two? And first question is, to what extent the technology should be exposed to the students?
Future lies in digital technology. So I'm not for one ever going to recommend restrictions on use of technology, because in fact within the intelligence community my view has always been not to restrict that, but to keep ourselves abreast with the development so that we are in one step ahead of what is available to the public. So I'm not going to suggest for one that keep your child away from digital technology, because therein lies the growth and the source of information. But the example that I gave about my daughter, them and talking about. So let me mention while responding to this question. The grey area that we are talking about is, you know, today the radical ideologies believe and see the world as black and white. Either you are with us or you are with them. But majority of the people in the world actually operate in the grey area. We take some good things here, some bad things from there, or some good things from there. Our entire philosophy in India is grey. You know, this is also good, that is also good. We can go to this temple, we can go to that temple, we can go to this mazar. That is the grey area. And actually the grey area which falls between two extremities is the area also of coexistence. But the effort today that is being made is to reduce or annihilate the grey area. Why do you think the attack on Paris took place? The Islamic State was expanding, maintaining in Syria and Iraq. His predecessor Osama bin Laden had made a mistake of 9/11 by attacking America, and then Afghanistan, etc., etc., was bombed.
Can we please give him a huge round of applause?